Good morning, everyone. Who's ready to worship Jesus in the house this morning? Hey, let's all stand up to our feet. Give God some glory. Give God some praise. Holy Spirit, we welcome you today. We thank you that you planned this day out a long time ago. We love you and we praise you and we open up our hearts to you. And we bless you this morning, Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen.
So in our fight, Says that God inhabits the praise of his people. So if we didn't think that God was here when we walked in the door, we know he's here now. You know, we're in a day and a time when people, you see videos all the time of people that are getting apprehended while singing praises to God outside. We're seeing a time that the faith is attacked like never before, but our victory is in Jesus. You know, Paul went to prison many times. I love what John MacArthur said when he was asked, what will happen if you go to prison for the stance you've made in opening your church? He said, well, I guess I'll start a prison ministry. I've never done that before. And if we could take our lives that way and have that level of confidence in Christ, then the victory is already ours. And whether we realize it or not, the victory is already ours. We wake up in the morning, the time we give to Him, the fact that we belong to Him, the victory is ours. In Jesus' name.
I'm gonna see your victory. a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. You take what the enemy meant for evil. You turn it for good. You turn it for good.
And say, you look good. Now point back at somebody and say, quit flirting with me. You may be seated. All right. All right. I've got a little prop this morning. So y'all are in for a real treat today. How many's glad to be in the house of the Lord today? Yes. And we want to welcome you if you're watching online today. Many people are out of town and doing things and busy, and so we welcome you. I was talking with someone earlier who lives in Fort Worth, but they're here today. And they said, we love this church. We're going to make this church at least once or twice a month. And I said, man, I'm so excited about that. And when you're not here, you're still a part of our church watching online. So many of you are out there watching online. We love you. We miss you. And y'all can be my witness. There ain't nothing like being here, but we understand. So this morning, before I get started on the seven trumpets of Revelation, I want to thank people that were out here working really hard yesterday. If you were out here, just stand up. Let's give these guys a hand of praise this morning, working hard. Yes, thank you so much. You can tell who they are because they walk around with like a red face, you know. And so the sun was pretty bright. And thank you. Pardon our dust again. We're remodeling back here. We got a couple sections of fence up, and we've got the tubes lined out, and kind of it's going to take us a few weeks, but we're going to get that playland built back there for our kids. Isn't that going to be great? It's going to be an outdoor playland. Yes. That's why we're putting up fencing around, because we don't want any kids running off the ledge. But we'll have a gated, very safe, very secure, padded with rubber foam on the floor. So if one of our kids trips, they're going to bounce back up. Amen. But anyway, thank you so much, guys. I can't thank you enough. You're saving the church a lot of money, by the way, by volunteering your labor. Especially Daryl Peoples back there welding. He was welding the two Daryls. We thank you all so much for your talents. And then the other thing that I want to mention before we get started is Tuesday is a very important day because it begins a early voting period, I believe, unless they've changed it in our in Texas. So I just want to encourage you, please go out and vote. This is one of the most historic and important elections. Please go vote. And I would encourage you as a pastor to vote the Bible. That's all I'll say. Just vote the Bible. It's not about personalities. It's about platform. Look at what each candidate stands for and which lines up with the Bible, and vote the Bible. Amen. Because as Danny beautifully put it, the church is under attack. And we got to sing a little louder. I love that song, and when they're leading that and singing that, I want to say, I'm doing as best as I can. I'm doing as loud as I can, okay? Let's sing a little louder. All right. But anyway, all right, let's get into the word today. Father, we're so thankful for your word. We thank you for the many nuggets we can glean out of it. We thank you that we're living in these times that are towards the end, we believe. But we give you all the glory and all the praise and all the honor. And Lord, we are going to stand up and fight spiritually. We're going to be strong. And we thank you that we do know the end of the story. And there was victory laid out over 2,000 years ago. Jesus, when you died on the cross, went down to hell and took the keys of the grave and death. And you gave us eternal life and you resurrected to prove it. We thank you for it. Give you glory. We set aside all distractions and we focus on you. In Jesus' name, amen. I'd like to thank my brother for lending me this trumpet. Now, in the Bible days, a trumpet was a very important instrument because there were watchmen set up on walls and hilltops, and they had trumpets, which were probably made of ram's horns, things like that. How many of you are familiar with a Jewish instrument called the shofar? Yep. My first experience with a shofar, I never heard of one, didn't know what one was, and they had this revival years ago in Pensacola, and we took 2 busloads as a church down there to Pensacola. Some of you might have been on that bus, and we had a great time. It was a great revival, many miracles, but I don't know how you worship, but the way I worship is just like this. I usually have my eyes closed and my hands up, and I just kind of get lost in Jesus. That's how I worship. You know, everybody worships in a different way. But I'm doing that. I've got my hands up, and I'm focused on God, and we're singing some song. And all of a sudden, this spontaneous praise just begins to break out. And all of a sudden, loud and proud, boop, 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 boop. And I thought it was the rapture. I thought, here I come, Jesus. And I even did like this. I was gonna help God, because I thought that was the final trumpet, you know. And here I go. And then I started getting worried. Oh, Father, forgive me for all my sins. I've been left behind. Lord, forgive me. And I looked around and I saw some people. And I go, wait a second. He's still here. She's still here. I'm still here. Something. This ain't the rapture. And I discovered that some guy was in the audience with a shofar and blew it. It's symbolic. It literally means the breath of God. And whenever the high praise hits the church, he would blow the shofar to symbolize the high praise going to the heavens. But it was pretty freaky for me, okay? But in the Bible days, the trumpet had 3 purposes. Well, really 4. One, the obvious one, was to praise and worship God. The second one was the watchmen were on the hills and on the walls, and they would blast the trumpet. I don't know how this is going to go because I can't play the trumpet, okay? There it is. There it is. All right. I'll get going here in a minute. But they would blast the trumpet, and they had certain codes. If they did 2 blasts, it meant something, or 3 blasts. But one of them was that one of the codes was they would make a declaration, like they would make an announcement. So, and even in the old days, they had a town crier, you know, in the 1800s that would be in the town square, and he'd ring a bell or he'd sound a trumpet or do something to get everybody's attention, and he'd make an announcement. Well, in Israel, they would blow the shofar, they would blow the trumpet, and every 50 years was the year of Jubilee. And on that time, when they blew the trumpet, they would do this. Only better. And they would say, your debts have been canceled, your burden has been lifted, and you've been set free. Wouldn't you love that? You know why they don't do that anymore? Because all of you would take your credit card and max it out in year 49. That's why they don't do that anymore. But every 50 years, the burden was lifted. The debt was canceled.
and they've been set free. You know what, though? I got good news for you. We don't have to do that every 50 years, because when you belong to Jesus Christ, your burden has been lifted, your debt has been canceled, and you've been set free. Amen? So they would use it as a declaration. They would also use the trumpet as an alarm for the enemy is coming to attack. They had a certain code that they would blast the trumpet, and it meant the enemy's coming, prepare for battle. And so the trumpet alarm would sound, and all the men would get on their gear and get their swords and get their weapons and be prepared for the attack. The third purpose of a trumpet was to call people to an assembly. There was another code to call people to an assembly. So to call to an assembly, to warn, a warning device, an alarm, and then also to make a declaration. Can I share with you that the trumpets in Revelation have the same purpose? The trumpets in Revelation are a call to assembly, because the Bible says on the final trumpet, on the last trumpet, we are going to be gone in a blink of an eye, and we're going to look up and we're going to be standing before Jesus. Isn't that great? So it's a call to assembly. All Christians, hey, come out. It's also, these other trumpets are also called there for a warning sound that, hey, the tribulation is here, or the tribulation is coming. Times are going to, this is a warning. This is prepare. Prepare for battle. The Battle of Armageddon, for instance. That's one of the trumpets I'm going to talk about. Then the other one, of course, when we hear that trumpet, we're going to be praising Jesus. Amen. But of course, also, it's to make a declaration. And it's Jesus to say, come on, bride. Come on, bride. Welcome into heaven. Well done, good and faithful. So even in the Bible times, make a declaration, call to assembly, or a warning, all three of those, or praise to God, all four purposes are still in these trumpets that I'm going to share with you, okay? Now, these seven trumpets, I'm not going to have time to go over all seven in detail. I'm going to pick a few in detail and just breeze through the other ones and tell you. You can do your own research. A lot of this research that I'm going to share with you comes from a guy by the name of Irvin Baxter. Anybody ever heard of Irvin Baxter? Now, he is a historicist. So remember I told you about the different views of Revelation? So you could interpret these trumpets from a futurist position that none of these has happened yet. But I'm going to share with you information that's pretty interesting to me, that maybe some of these have happened and some are yet to come. Okay? So I'm going to start, well, let's look at the scripture. Let's look at Revelation 8:6. It says this, then the seven angels, and by the way, all seven of these trumpets you can find in Revelation 8, Revelation 9, and Revelation 11. And you can also, in 1 Corinthians 15 and other places, talks about these as well. But then the seven angels with the seven trumpets prepared to blow their mighty blast. Now, depending on how you interpret the next part, could mean some of the trumpets have already sounded, or all seven are about to come. Okay? I'm the kind of pastor that wants you to make up your own mind. I don't. Other than the core values that we all agree to, I won't, how you interpret the end times and things like that, that's between you and God. And I hope you're praying right now, God, reveal to me your scripture. I want to understand eschatology. I want to understand the end times. So, here's the angels, they prepare to blow, and I'm going to go to Revelation 8, verse 10 and 11, because this is the third trumpet, and I want to share this with you, because this is very, very interesting to me, that may kind of lean more on the historicist side. But then the third angel blew his trumpet, and a great star fell from the sky. Now you have to say, you have to understand, this is John writing 2,000 years ago, and he didn't have words like nuclear, tanks, helicopters, so he would describe those things in the vision that he saw in the language of his day. Are you with me so far? So he said, I saw this great star fall from the sky, and burning like a torch, it fell on one-third of the rivers and on the springs of water. And then it says, the name of the star, the King James says, was Wormwood. The New Living Translation, it goes ahead and translate the meaning of it. It says the name of the star was bitterness. If you have a King James Bible, you'll see wormwood. If you have a modern translation, you'll see the name of the star was bitterness. The meaning of the star was bitterness. Now, here's something very interesting. If you had a Ukrainian Bible and you opened it up and you saw a modern translation, there's two different translations, but one of them, the word would be Chernobyl. The name of the star was Chernobyl. So if we go back to that scripture and continue reading, it made one-third of the water bitter, and many people died from drinking the bitter water. Now, a lot of these trumpets and a lot of these things that we read, some are throughout the whole world, and some are just in the region where the event happened, okay? So you have to understand that as you interpret these things. But there was radiation that leaked out of Chernobyl as far as Europe. The streams carried the radiation. And many, many people got cancer, and many, many people did die in that region because two scientists decided to play with nuclear radiation. And they took it too far. In fact, those two Russian scientists had to ignore 6 warning alarms that were going it off. But they wanted to see how close they could take it before a nuclear meltdown. Guess what? They went too far. The nuclear meltdown happened. And I can imagine John looking at this glowing radiation that we all, well, not all, because we got a lot of young people here. Y'all, if y'all don't even know what I'm talking about, y'all got to just look it up. Just Google it and stuff. But some of you know. But it's part of our history that happened in Russia, now Ukraine, that they had a nuclear meltdown. And could it be that John had a vision of that, and that was the third trumpet? Could it be? Or is it going to happen in the future? Let's look at another trumpet here. Let's look at the next scripture. Revelation 8, 8 and 9. Okay, I'm going to go backwards a little bit. Then the second angel blew his trumpet. So I talked about the third trumpet. Well, what was the second trumpet then? And a great mountain of fire was thrown into the sea. Again, John is seeing this, describing it in his own words. Interesting. One-third of the water in the sea became blood. The third of all things living in the sea died. And watch this. One-third of all ships on the sea were destroyed. Do you know what happened in World War II? In World War II, there was 105,127 ships. They're all named. You can actually go on, and it's 66 pages long, but you can read the name of each ship. 105,127 ships, 36,387, approximately one-third of all ships were destroyed. Could it be the second trumpet was already sounded in a worldwide event? And when you read that scripture and you say, I saw like a mountain of fire glowing and into the sea, that was the first time a nuclear bomb was ever dropped, Hiroshima and Nagasaki. So could that be that the second trumpet was already sounded? Or is it about to happen? You decide, you do the research, you pray, you interpret for yourself, okay? Now, let's look at the next one. Coming up, the next scripture that we want to talk about is Revelation 9. Now we're going to move to the fifth trumpet, and it says, the fifth angel blew his trumpet. I'll spare your ears. I won't do it again. When I play the trumpet, I sound like a wounded calf on a foggy night sometimes, you know. But you deserve better. If you came in late, I played a blast of Laura. Maybe I'll do one at the end. I did one time when I was preaching a message like this. I had somebody hidden, and I said, now when I get to the end and I talk about the second coming of Jesus, I want you to blast that trumpet. But in respect for elderly people with heart conditions, I don't do that anymore, okay? But the fifth angel blew his trumpet, and I saw a star that had fallen to the earth from the sky, and he was given the key to the shaft of the bottomless pit. When he opened it, smoke poured out as though from a huge furnace, and the sunlight and the air turned dark. from the smoke. Then locusts came from the smoke. Now remember, this is John's vision. He's describing this. And descended on the earth. And they were given power to sting like scorpions. I want you to see if you can figure out what I believe he was talking about. They were told not to harm the grass or the plants or the trees, but only the people who did not have the seal of God on their foreheads. Let me ask you a question. Who has the seal of God on their forehead? Every believer, everyone that belongs to Jesus, and then also the 144,000 Jews that are mentioned in the book of Revelation. So, and it could be, I had a Jewish missionary stay with me just this week, a very delightful man. His name is Zev, and we support him. Part of our offering goes to him so that he can reach Jewish people for Jesus Christ, the Messiah. Amen. And so, and he has ways of doing that through social media and Facebook, and he goes over there for 6 months, and then he lives over here for 6 months. But he was in town. He stayed with us Tuesday night. Amy cooked a delicious meal, and he has an accent. You know, he's from Israel. He kind of talks, he has an accent, and he preached here one time, and I'll get him back again, but he would say, "This is a Jewish book. This is a Jewish book," you know, and he would talk like that. Some of you were here when we were meeting at Nebby Williams, and you remember that. But he is one of the few Jewish people that believe Jesus was the Messiah. There's a few of them around, but most of them do not accept Jesus as the Messiah. They are still waiting on the Messiah to come. But the Bible talks about that 144,000 in the tribulation period are sealed, and 12,000 from each tribe. In fact, I asked Zev, "What tribe are you from?" Because I was curious, and he goes, "I'm actually from the tribe of Levi." And I said, "That is so cool, man. Not only are we supporting a Jewish person, not only are we supporting a Jewish person that's doing God's work in Israel, but not only, we're also supporting a Levite." And that is just so cool. Because if you know your Old Testament history, the Levites were the only ones that didn't have an inheritance. All the other tribes got inheritance, but the Levites, they just depended on tithes and offerings. So, and by the way, we're thankful for all of you that support LifeSpring Church and the vision here in your tithe and offering. Many of you do that online. Many of you do that here. We're so thankful. So, as we go on, they were told not to kill them, but to torture them for 5 months. Now, pay attention to that period of time. With pain, like the pain of a scorpion sting. In those days, people will seek death, but will not find it. They will long to die. Not death, but will flee from them. The locusts look like horses. Think of this in your mind. Prepared for battle. They had what looked like gold crowns on their head. And their faces looked like a human face. John is seeing this in his vision. They had hair like women, and I'll explain that here in a second, and teeth like the teeth of a lion. They wore armor made of iron, and their wings roared like an army of chariots rushing into battle. They had tails that sting like scorpions, and for 5 months they had the power to torment people. Now, as look back to that last slide again. I want to read it again, but I want you to think of a helicopter. A Bible guy like John was going to write about a helicopter in a vision, this is how he described it. He'd say they had looked like gold crowns on their heads, and their faces looked like human face, and they had hair like women's hair. In other words, they're going through the air, and I imagine there was a stream, and they had teeth like the teeth of a lion. They wore armor made of iron, and their wings roared like an army of chariots. Does that sound like somebody describing a helicopter to you, to the best of his ability? It does to me. So I believe John saw a vision of a war that involved helicopters. They had tails that sting like scorpions. They had, for 5 months, they had power to torment people. Their king, now this gets even more intense. Their king is the angel from the bottomless pit His name in Hebrew is Abaddon, and in Greek, Apollyon, or it means the destroyer. So his name means the destroyer. If you go to Aramaic and you look up a name, Sodom, you see it means the destroyer. You can go to that slide, Lisa. So historicists believe that this trumpet could have been sounded and represent the Gulf War. And you know how it said the sky was blackened, and remember how they burned all the oil wells? And there was smoke rising up that John would say from a bottom, and he saw helicopters. And if you remember that war that happened in the 90s and then it happened again later, that vision could have described the fifth trumpet. Are you with me so far? All right, haven't lost anybody. So now let's look at the next one. Because this now, if you believe the historicist model, you believe that right now in history, we are between the fifth and the sixth trumpet, okay? And by the way, I should mention, and I don't have time to go there, but the first trumpet, there's a lot of evidence it could have been World War I, and the fourth trumpet, it could have been, Irvin Baxter describes it as speeding up of time, it could have been Mount St. Helens also, could have been different events, but I want to spend some time on, now we all agree, historicists and futurists, this one is to come. The sixth trumpet is to come. And it says, the sixth angel blew his trumpet, and I heard a voice speaking from the four horns of gold, of the gold altar that stands in the presence of God. That's going to be cool to check that out, isn't it? That's going to be cool to check out. The golden altar that stands in the presence of God. And the voice said to the sixth angel who held the trumpet, release the four angels who are bound at the great Euphrates River. God assigned four angels that are still standing there now, because their assignment is to just do this. And when this trumpet is, not this one, but when that trumpet is sounded, that is the angel's command, and the voice will say, release, you're released, so that they know what to do. The four angels who had been prepared for this hour and day and month and year were turned loose to kill one third of all people on earth. Now that's not regional. That's one third of all the people on earth. And I believe in the tribulation period when the sixth trumpet is sounded. And by the way, if you don't know, if you're new to all this, there's not literally going to be, you're not going to hear a trumpet sound. Like if you live in Rockwall, every Wednesday, I mean, the first Wednesday of the month at 2 o'clock, you hear, they practice their tornado warning deal. And all the dogs start going, but, so you're not going to hear a literal trumpet. It's symbolic. There might be a little trumpet that sounded in heaven, but I don't believe you'll hear it on this earth. Are you with me? A lot of this stuff is symbolic. But there is a war coming, a great world war. One third of people on earth will die. So when the four angels who had been prepared for this hour and day, it says, I heard the size of their army. Now, catch this. Which was 200 million mounted troops. There's one army in the world right now that has 200 million troops at least. China. Isn't it interesting how China really wasn't in the news much, but now China's in the news quite a bit. And I don't know if you saw this or not, but there are Chinese soldiers in Canada stationed right now just north of the border on Vancouver Island, isn't it? You guys sent me that information. There, just in case you don't know, about one in every five people in the world are Chinese. They have got the biggest population. And 200 million troops is not hard for them to do. So, and in my vision, I saw horses. I want you to think about this. And riders sitting on them. The riders wore armor that was fiery red and dark blue and yellow. By the way, sometime I was looking up the uniforms, and some of the new uniforms in China are blue. And then Russia, of course, red. But the horses had heads like lions, and the fire and the smoke, burning sulfur billowed from their smoke. And one-third of all the people on the earth were killed by these plagues, by the fire and the smoke and burning sulfur that came from the mouths of these horses. You know what I believe he was describing in his words that he understood? I believe he was describing tanks. Did you? Anybody else think that? Tanks. I don't know. You got some of you guys served in the military. And by the way, if you served in the military, we like to do this quite often, church. Come on. We respect our veterans. Some of you are still serving. Some of you at home, thank you very much. Thank you that we have freedom in this country because you're willing to lay your life down for that freedom. And it's kind of similar to what we preach here. There was one man who laid his life down and gave us all freedom. Oh, come on, somebody. The greatest soldier ever, Jesus Christ. Right? All right. The rest of you will get saved. Don't worry. Just stick around a little bit. So it goes on to say, with the power to injure people. But the people who did not, now I want you to catch this to see how relevant this is today. The people who weren't killed by these plagues still refused to repent of their evil deeds and turn to God. They continued to worship demons and idols made of gold, silver, bronze, stone, and wood. Idols that could neither see nor hear nor walk. And I believe what John is referring to there is a spirit of materialism, that people with the gold, the silver, the things of this earth, that a lot of people fall into that trap and worship those things. And they did not repent. Now he's going to mention four sins. And I want you to think about the four most common sins of today. They did not repent of their murders. And the Greek word there is phonos. And it literally means slaughter of the innocent. I can't help but think of how many millions, somebody probably knows the number in here, I should have looked it up. I think it's, is it 60 million? Every year die in a mother's womb because a doctor slaughters a baby. And I am not here to condemn you if you've had an abortion or participated in abortion. I'm here to tell you that God restores. God restores. And I was talking to my wife about this. I have a 23-year-old son that lives at home. And I thank God for my 23-year-old son. He's finally getting married, and we're finally going to be free. In July of next year. So, but I was just thinking about this. Because I hear in the news people say, well, a woman should have right over her body. But in God's eyes, whether the baby is 23 years old and lives in my house, I have no right to slaughter that baby in my house. And when a little baby is inside a mother's womb for 23 days, you have no right to slaughter that innocent baby inside of your home. You can disagree with me, and that's okay. But I'm just here to preach what I believe the Word says. And one of the sins that they did not repent of in the end days was slaughter of innocent people. Second one, it says, or their witchcraft. Now, the Greek word there is pharmakeia. Pharmakeia. Drug abuse. I don't know how it got interpreted as witchcraft. I guess when you're on drugs, you probably do see a lot of witchcraft stuff. I don't know. I've never, thank God, and thank the prayers of my parents, I've never done drugs. But we have many people in here that are pastors today and use their gift today because they were hooked to meth amphetamines. They were hooked to different kinds of drugs, LSD, you know, and it gets, we got so many great stories at Life Spring Church, and I know that God is so proud of you because you did repent, and you did turn and walk away from that drug, and you no longer abuse drugs because you've been set free. Your debt has been canceled. You don't have to spend $80 a day anymore to buy drugs and work for drugs. But in the end days, the Bible says they don't repent of their drug abuse. And by the way, drug abuse is not just illegal drugs. It can be legal drugs, too. There's a lot of police officers that we have at our church that know a lot more about this than I do. I don't know. But, okay, the third, I know the Bible. I'll share the Greek words with you all day long. We'll rap about it. This word, or their sexual immorality, do you know what that word is in the Greek? Pornia. Pornography. They did not repent of their pornography. They did not repent of their drug abuse. They did not repent of their abortions. And then the last one is theft. You know, it's kind of funny. And that word is, by the way, klepto. You ever heard kleptomaniac? And I think it's so interesting that the Bible uses that word theft, that's one of the sins that they didn't repent of, because in the city of Dallas, you can go down to 7-Eleven, help yourself to up to 750 stuff, their stuff, and walk out, and there's no harm, no foul. In fact, one of the teachers that goes to this church overheard kids talking, and they said, hey, don't rob the 7-Elevens in Rockwall. You will go to jail, and you will be prosecuted. Go down to Dallas and do that. It's the truth. But, I mean, that's why we need godly people in government, godly people in teaching and in universities, and godly people in the media. Amen? All right. So, finally, the last trumpet. The last trumpet. I'll do it one more time. I'll see. I don't know. It's going to sound a lot better than that in heaven. Some of you know I don't know how to play this thing, but I can make a joyful noise. But the last trumpet will sound, and Jesus Christ will come back to take his bride to be with him forever. Look at the scripture on this. I love this. Revelation 11, 15 to 18. We'll close with this. Musicians, singers, y'all can come on up. Then the seventh angel blew his trumpet. The last trumpet in Revelation, I believe, is the same last trumpet in 1 Corinthians 15 when it says the dead will be resurrected first and then those who are alive will remain and be caught up with him. It says the seventh angel blew his trumpet and there was a loud voice shouting in heavens, the world has now become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he will reign forever and ever. And the 24 elders sitting on their thrones before God fell down and their faces to the ground and worshiped him. And they said, we give thanks to you, Lord God, the Almighty, the one who is, the one who always was, and the one who is to come. For you have assembled your great power and have begun to reign. The nations were filled with wrath, but now the time of your wrath has come. It is the time to judge the dead and reward your servants, the prophets. That's going to be exciting when we get to heaven. And the judgment day is there. And there's going to be people, the Bible says, on the left and people on the right. And the Bible says the people on the left are like goats in the Bible language. People on the right are like sheep. And he's going to say, sadly, to one group of people, sorry, your destination is not here in heaven. It's eternal damnation to hell. And the other group, he's going to say, well done, good and faithful servants of mine. Enter into the joy of the Lord. And it says, servants and prophets, as well as your holy people and all who fear your name, from the least to the greatest, it is time to destroy all who have caused destruction on the earth. And so, I want to give you a chance right now. Maybe some of you are walking with Jesus every day. You're in fellowship. You're in a good relationship with him. Maybe some of you are here today or watching online today, and maybe it's been a minute. It's been a while since you actually got your heart square with God. Maybe your story is like mine, where I was raised in a pastor's home. I got saved when I was 6 years old. But as I grew older and older and older in my 20s, I got so far away from God. So far. But I remember the day, thankfully, praise God, for praying parents and a praying wife, praying family, that when I turned 33, I came back to Jesus Christ. It's never, ever too late to come back to Jesus Christ. Or maybe you're here today and you don't know what I'm talking about. What's this about a relationship with Jesus Christ? I want you to bow your heads and close your eyes and reflect for just a second. And I want you to think in your mind, which one am I? Am I that first person? Well, I feel like my walk with Jesus is great, and every day I have fellowship with him, and you know, I'll be praying for everyone else in here. Or am I that person who it's been a minute since I got in touch with God, and I don't know how my relationship is. I don't know if it's right with God or not. Or am I that person, third person I was describing this, man, I need to get that relationship with Jesus. If you're here today and you identify with that second or third person, don't waste time. Lift your hand up right now. We're not going to embarrass you. Yes, lift your hand up now. Anyone else? Yes, yes. Lift your hand up now. Show God you mean business. So show God you're serious with him. Yes, thank you. Lift your hand up now. Yes, thank you. Thank you. You know, it's the most important decision you will ever make, which you just did. So I want us all to pray with those that raise their hands. Because no matter what happens on the earth, whether we go through these things or whether they are to come, our faith can be strong and he can be our rock. And so let's all pray this prayer right now. Can we say, Heavenly Father, I thank you for your son Jesus, who came to this earth and died on the cross for the mistakes, the sins, and the failures of mankind. I ask you, Jesus, to forgive me for those sins, for those mistakes, for those failures. I acknowledge you as my Savior. Come into my heart, and I acknowledge you as my Lord. I belong to you. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Come on, can we give God some praise? Because the Bible says that when that happens, all of heaven rejoices. Man, what a party. They must be rejoicing up there every other second. Like, hey, another one got saved. Yeah. All right. Woohoo. Way to go. So, anyway, I just wanted to prepare you for the trumpets that either are to come, or some have already sounded and some that are to come. But however you want to interpret it, it's up to you. But we got to be ready. We got to be ready. We got to be ready. God bless you. Pastor Robert, come up and close us out. Feel free to blast the trumpet if you want.
Y'all think Rex is bad on an instrument. I'm horrible. Hey, a couple quick announcements. Hey, don't forget, we have men's work day Saturday. Please come. Let me move this out of the way because there we go. Now you can see what I mean. Hey, Saturday work day is the men's work day. And that same day, women are going to go shopping. So I don't know how that got messed up. I mean, Amy set that up or something. Men have to work and women are going shopping. But come be a part of it. We want you to be a part. If you need a reminder of stuff, scan the QR code. It'll be out here. It can be up there. Get your phone out. Scan it right there. Take a picture of me and it'll pop up your on your calendar. But it lets you know what's going on. Lets you know all the events of the week. I think we have millennial marriage this week. We have different things throughout the week. But that code will come up and it'll tell you what's going on. Monday chili cook-off. I'm sorry. Oh, totally forgot about the yes. come be a part of that. I will be cooking chili. You can vote for mine. It will be the best one here. sorry, Danny. I know you beat me last year, but I got you. I'm going to get you this year. All right. So come, yes, be a part. Chili cook-off. This Monday at 6:30. Hey, before we go, I want to read the scripture. It's the scripture of victory. And it's found in Romans 8, verses 35 and 37. It says, can anything separate us from Christ's love? Does it mean he no longer loves us? If we have troubles or we have calamities or we are persecuted or we're hungry or destitute or in danger or threatened with death? It says, no, despite all things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ Jesus who loves us. So I want you to take that this week. No matter what you're going through, we have overwhelming victory. Overwhelming, like we're conquerors. We have overwhelming victory through Christ Jesus. So also there's tithing. There's like 15 ways to give, or five, whatever. So in person, in the bucket, you can text it in. You can give online. You can do all that. I want to pray a prayer of blessing and a prayer of victory over you for this week. Heavenly Father, Lord, we come before you today, Lord, and we say thank you. Thank you for coming before us and setting a path for us, Lord, a path of victory, that we may walk in the shadow, Lord. Good, you are with us. You are there for us, and we have victory coming through the other side, through you, Jesus Christ. Lord, we pray that you would just allow everyone this week to have an amazing victory where you show up in a mighty way and that we can witness to someone this week, Lord God. We thank you and we praise you, Lord. We give you honor and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful and victorious week.